praising God. When you're praying, when you're fellowshipping, don't be in a hurry. I've taught you one thing today. Demons are never in a hurry. They settle down. Say, as far as this one is concerned, immigration matter zero. As far as this one is concerned, business zero. But I came with good news. Who is he that said and it come to pass? When God himself commanded it up. Someone here, you are being settled in the name of Jesus. Your amen is from Akwa Ibom. That one is from Owerri. That one is from Akwa. A father, you are a mother here. Who you are of? Hallelujah. I have so many of them.
What?
If your son or your daughter came and was giving you praises, you know, my children, I think they came from heaven.
Amen.
When they asked for something,
hi.
Some of them waving me down.
Yeah.
And they'll ask for me. They'll feel all praise you. Then you are the best dad in the world. And when I came to that, they said, I tell everyone in school about you. You are the best dad. What did you want, sweet? After I gave him, I did not, they need to eat before they eat sweets. But because I heard those praises, my head went another direction. I did not think about the rules of sex. I just said, take. And guess what? He said, thank you very, 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 very much. I said, do you want some more? He said, yes, take. He said, no. Yes. Praises. The Bible says that God inhabits the praises of his people. 99.7% of you don't praise God at home. So when you come to church again, you are in the hell, you are thinking about that job. God gave you that job. If he takes it away, to look for another one, it'll be easy. When you come to just settle down, the demons fighting us, they have settled down. So you care, you turn around. How can a demon come and be fighting me in the dream? Using someone else's. Why? Because I was in my point of weakness. I'll tell you as it is. I was tired. My wife is here. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I frustrated their plans in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Can I have a Christmas program, please? It's announcement time. Do we all have the Christmas programs?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Please, there's a mistake on it. I want to stand with that. But before that, if there's anyone here who is worshiping with us for the first time, can
in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Glad for Jesus and may be seated. Sit down.
So I'm just playing something slowly. You know, I was sitting there, the Holy Ghost was telling me that, you know, I started like a judgmental thing. He said, calm down. That though you are dressed like someone wants to release judgment. Say, but be a lamb today. So I pray that I should not go down this place. You know, Jesus has two natures. One, he acted like the lion of the tribe of Judah 29 times in the Bible. And then only once he acted like the lamb. So even if this is the only time you see me like a lamb, please take it. Last week, I said I'll not go down this place. I went down. My wife is like that. She's my own pastor at home. So when I'm on this altar, I'm very careful what I say. Because she'll come and tell me, you said this. That's not how it was. Three, you said it was two. So she came home and said, you're a liar. My heart skipped. I said, what do you mean, sweet man, I'm a liar? Not angry with her, but you know that scared. And she said, you lie in church. I said, I was so inquisitive. Say, what do you mean by lying in church? What did I say that was a lie? She said, you said you will not come down on the altar and you came down. If you see I was calm, it's just that she chased her own at the house. It looks more to me, but that's a lie. Hallelujah. I went and I said, God have mercy. I lie in church. It's better to say that to attract the rod of God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So when I'm saying things here, I'm careful because she's taking note. When I get home, she say, he said it. You know, people don't understand. When two get married, they become one. So the sin of one can affect the others. So if the wife, God told me this very clearly, For example, if my wife is sinning, she's not sinning. If she's sinning, and then I know it and I'm quiet, that sin affects me. Because if God blesses me and has withheld her blessing, I will bless her. And God does not want to bless at that time till she repents. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
So when the Bible says two shall become one, the sin of one can affect the other.
Yes, sir.
So that's why you have to put each other in check. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Am I blessing someone?
Yes, sir.
Today, briefly, we shall be finishing a series. I was standing here. No person can move me.
Amen.
We shall be finishing a series quickly. I have 15 minutes and I'm gone. Last week on making a plan as a principle to finish the year strong and entering 2019 with ease. Last week we established from the Bible how God sent his disciples out but never gave them anything. He never gave them money. He gave them nothing but power and vision. We also said that God walking with a man is not by money. God is with a man. Is not the wealth. Does that make sense? God can give you wealth, but he does not approve of the things you do. If that's the case, then faith people say the houses they are building, the cars they are driving. If that's the case, then you'll say God is with them when they come to church. That's why in some places they'll come and put them at the front. Because of what is coming out. So the fact that a man is loaded, the fact that a man is wealthy does not mean that God is with that man. The fact that a man is in the choir singing and people are falling under the anointing, it does not mean that God is still with that man. I've told you again and again, the gifts of God are free of charge. Now when God gives you a gift, he does not take it back. I told you that God says, shut your mouth as far as you concern the prophesying and prophesying. Shut your mouth for now. He told me that. So some of the times you see me prophesying here is disobedient. And I've learned my lesson the hard way. You guys understand. That God, that a man has money, he has gifts. When God gives you a gift, he does not take it back, sir. You like you fall, you like it, he does not take it back. He remains there. The only thing is you will be void of the presence of God. You'll be void of the anointing of God. But the gifts are still in you. You can still prophesy. You can still pray in tongues. You see, Papa, pray in tongues. But you look at their shoe, it's looking to heaven. Why? Because the gifts are there. But because they are not working according to the rules, the gifts are not producing the results. I just said that now. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We said last week that God does not normally release resources except you have a plan. We said a vision without a plan is an impossibility. A vision without a plan is an impossibility. And we said in whatever you do, without a plan that you present to God, you will end up like others. Without a plan, you will end up like others. That will not be your story in the name of Jesus. I prophesy and I decree that as you present your plan to God next Sunday, after that, divine resources will be coming to you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I don't like that amen at all.
Amen.
So we will quickly present in our plans on Sunday. Many people say, Pastor, I'm not ready with my plan. We have pushed it to next Sunday. Go back and ask God, what do you want me to do in 2019? What would you have me to do like a business? What would you, so because you have to write a plan about everything, about your children, about everything. You have to write a plan that you present to God. And I believe that God will answer us in the name of Jesus. Proverbs 16:9, let's read together. Proverbs 16:9, it says, the heart of a man devises his way. My version says, the heart of a man plans his way. But the Bible says that God establishes it. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
God establishes it. My Bible says the path of a man plans his way, but it is the Lord that establishes his way. If you enter a year without the plan for that year, then you are entering a year without the direction of God. A plan for your children, a plan for your career, a plan for your business. You can, like I told you, it was one of the year 4 years ago that I wrote a plan. I even included cars. And 4 years after, we have the cars. They were included in the plan. Plane was included in the plan. I've not seen the plane. I'll see one day. Hallelujah.
Amen.
though the vision carries, wait for it. I don't want a plane to show up. A plane is to take the gospel up and down. I miss flights a lot. And the money I pay is unbelievable. You can connect two flights and you are even cheaper out. Hallelujah. Yeah. So the plane is for the gospel. Whatever you're asking God for in 2019, it must be for the glory of God.
Amen.
When I asked God for a car, I said, God, to establish your work at Well and Fire Ministry. That's what it was. You want a house that all paid for, say, God, so that house fellowship will hold in that house. Say something good. Hallelujah. Don't ask for a house because you want to do parties in the house. God will not give you that. Because you are asking to satisfy the flesh. You are asking for your own personal aggrandizements. So after you have written the plan and made it plain, you present it to the Lord, which you will do on Sunday in prayers. And he will now establish it by providing the provisions first, providing the resources for the plan. So today we shall go a step further by looking at the power of planning. The power of planning. As we earlier mentioned, that a new year is just another year without proper planning of what you expect God to do in that year. Last year we entered 2018, we had nothing in mind. Nothing, no plan was established. Or many had to put out a plan here and they did not go back and put God in remembrance. A new year is an opportunity to take another look at the vision that God gave you for your life, for your business, for your ministry, for your family, for your children, and to look alive in a fresh perspective. A new year also gives you an opportunity to refocus on your goals. Sometimes you take your plan, you have some things canceled, and you may add some things. Does that make sense? So a new year gives you an opportunity to add and to subtract to the plans of God for your life. Notice that when you make a plan for this year, it does not mean that all will come to pass that year. No, sir. For the vision is for an appointed time. I had plans 4 years ago, it has not still come. And even if it come now, say, back to sender. Why would I say back? How can I keep a plane now? Hallelujah.
Amen.
So God will not give you what will kill you. Some of you will not give your child a car to drive. Indirectly, you are saying, take the key and go and die and prepare your coffin. So God will never give you anything that will not be for his glory. Anything that will kill you. That job that you may have lost, it was his will. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It means that God has another one prepared for you. Child of God, change, they say, is the only constant thing in nature. Change happens all the time. But I believe this year, 2019, change is going to be very drastic in your lives in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
I say, after you present a plan, it will be testimony galore in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
This year, I see God changing things in your life in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
This year, I see restorations in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
But to have this kind of change in 2019, we must plan and decide the changes we want to see. Last year, I said, God said that unfortunately, spectator, if you remember very carefully, for those who are taking notes and going back, and I said it clearly at the end of the year. I said, God said, spectators in 2018 will not benefit fully from the changes that he is bringing. And I said, God said that, however, why he be doing a new thing in the lives of some? He said, many people who don't know it, who will not remember their plan by putting him in remembrance of those things. Sir, that's why when we come to pray, we pray for the prayer request on that covenant. It's not enough to give it. It's enough. He says, put me in remembrance.
Yes.
Put me in remembrance. Abraham had to. He became at a point where Abraham was dissatisfied with God. He got to a place where he had to go back and say, God, where you promised me, it's more than 20 years and I'm still waiting. Abraham kept reminding God. He had to put God in remembrance. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Isaiah 43:26. Let's read together. Isaiah 43:26. If you are there, I'll be very slow. I have about 15 more minutes. I apologize for 30 minutes added to our time today. It says what? Let 3, 2, 1 go. Put me in remembrance. Let us plead together. Declare thou that thou may be justified. Does that make sense to anyone? And I said, God said we should not play religion. That we will have to decide 2018 by our written plans presenting them to him, but guess what? He reminded me that many forgot about those plans. Many had no time to go back and put God in remembrance of those things they wanted to achieve in 2018. In fact, they began to pursue different plans. They forget the other ones, they began to pursue different plans. Those ones who kept them now. He began to remind me about my car and my wife. I've told you already. So we must be responsible in 2019 to decide what happens in our lives by planning. And that is why we pray for the prayer request. I've already said that. The truth is that any year you don't plan for your life, that year will plan life for you. Any year you don't plan for, that year will plan life for you. That will not be your story in the name of Jesus. Child of God, the supernatural, the miraculous, automatically imposes on the natural when you have a plan and you pursue it diligently. Every day you put God in remembrance. Lord, my immigration breakthrough, you said in 2019 I'll have it. Where is it? You keep putting him in remembrance till you see it. And that's what Abraham did. You cannot miss it. You cannot be distracted by the other person buying the house. No. Your own case is different. Yes. Your own case is... Hannah had no choice, sir. Yes. The concubine had 9 kids. And the concubine was so provocative. When he wants to send one to the market, he will call 3 one time. John, Peter, Mary, come. Go to the market. Just to provoke Hannah. Because she had no child. But guess what? She kept putting God in remembrance. She forgot about her. And when God blessed her, one child, it was remembered till today. The 9 children of the concubine, do you know their names? We don't even know their names. Nobody remembers them. But that's a woman who said, I am diligent. She cried out. The Bible says she cried out from the voice of her heart. They thought she was drunk, sir. She was putting God in remembrance. Say, Jesus, remember me.
Jesus, remember me.
God told us last time to present our draft plans and back it up with prayers. And he will take over from there. This year, do something extraordinary. Me, even in my previous church, when they say fast in 7 days, guess what? I'll do more. Sometimes I'll do 14, sometimes I'll do 41. You must do extraordinary things to get extraordinary results. You must do extra. If you have 2 kids and you give them both an assignment and one comes back with an extraordinary, you will be proud of that one. You want to bless them more. That is the same way that God is. My prayer is that you shall not be a spectator in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Quickly, how do we plan our vision? There's a saying that he who fails to plan, plans to fail. Say never.
Never.
If you fail to plan, then you have planned to fail.
Never.
Say, Ben, that will not be your story. Sit down and plan if we are serious about fulfilling our dream. No one builds a house without planning first. Child of God, success is the orderly planning of your vision. Planning is faith, and faith in action is planning. When you plan, you are exercising faith. When you plan, you are exercising faith. When you plan, you are exercising faith. You are telling God that, God, regardless, I believe you for these things I'm presenting to you. God, regardless of what I see, I believe that you are able to do beyond my expectation in 2019. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the substance of things so far, the evidence of things not yet seen. When you present your plan to God, by the time you go out of this church, a brother will offend you. A sister offend you, you have a choice to answer or not to answer.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Offense will come, afflictions will come, battles will come. In fact, life is a battlefield.
Yes, sir.
Life is a battlefield. But the Bible says that he that runs to the end is whom that will have the crown.
Yes, sir.
He that runs according to the rules to the end. 2 Timothy 2:5. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So the ability for you to document the future is faith. God is a God of faith, and faith is believing in his promises. And be careful, because faith demands a plan. I told you last 2 weeks, you want to get married, don't wait till you have a million. Plan it and go ahead and do it. Take a step. Hallelujah. Take a step. God is not convinced that you are serious about your vision until he sees a plan. Maybe last year you wanted to get a plot of land. Did you have that as a plan? What did you do? Did you put God in remembrance? I don't know what you want, but God needs a plan. In fact, this just came to me. Even at creation, God had a plan. He had a plan for Adam and Eve. But what happened to the plan? He failed. The plan failed now. Ah, you guys are just looking at me. The plan did not fail. He failed. You were not meant to die. If Adam and Eve would have behaved themselves, Adam was basically naming the animals. Eve was basically talking with flowers and animals. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Adam was too busy. That's why we tell you to always spend time with your wives. Hallelujah. Because when you don't spend time with your wife, what happens is you begin to talk with other people. And when you talk with other people, you begin to say things that they are not supposed to say. Hallelujah. Adam was naming the animal. Eve was discussing with animals. And then, unfortunately, he met a serpent. And the serpent derailed him. He had to eat. We disobey God because of that. But when he failed, what happened? That was God's plan for us. God had to send Jesus. So God had a plan B. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God is not convinced about your vision until he sees a plan. So as far as God is concerned, planning is the highest expression of faith. Notice that God has a plan for you, but he does not plan for you. I like that. God has a plan for you. Jeremiah 29:11, what does it say? My plans for you are to prosper you and give you an expected end. That's his plans. That's God's plans for you, but he does not plan life for you, sir. Does that make sense?
Yes.
God does not plan life for you, but he has a plan for you. If God tells you to do something, if you don't document it and plan it to do it, then you simply don't believe it. It is as simple as that. Because if you believe it, then you plan for it. Without a plan in place, there is no self-control. Without a plan in place, there is no self-control. Without a plan in place, there, God said in one of our services, there will be 2 million. In another, there will be 1 million. So I am running with that. We have a mandate that speaks of what God wants to do at Word and Fire Ministry worldwide. That's like a plan for Word and Fire. And that's what I'm running with. So the day I come to church and I meet 2 people, you are seeing 2. I am seeing 2 million.
Amen.
Why? Because of the plan that has already been established. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Your own is to stick with the plan that you have presented to God, regardless of the affliction. And don't be distracted. Many people are distracted. My pastors here, they know when I have a meeting and you say, in my previous church, that's low level Christianity. So low level. Because God runs with a man at his own pace. The way God works with you is not the way God works with you. That's why there's no power in the church anymore. Because everybody is only looking at what the neighbor is doing to imitate. Nobody wants to hear from God directly. And that's what we teach here. That's why Aaron died like a non-entity. In the life, Aaron was, his name meant mountaineer. But he never settled down to know God for himself. He was looking at Moses instead of looking at the God that Moses was serving. And that's what we are trying to impute in your head in this church all the time. God can use you more than me. In fact, far better than me. If I mess up, whoever is ready is who God will use. God is not a respecter of person. John 14:12. If ye believe the things that I do, you shall do them, and even double shall you do. But if you believe. There are churches where a pastor is preaching on the altar, there's a general in the crowd. Do what God wants to do, you'll be blessed accordingly. Church is not a place where you go and compare. Obviously, don't get me wrong. You can go to a church and there's an idea that will come from there. And many people don't understand that the church you're talking about, they started like us. When they were like us 2 years, when they were 2 years, maybe there were only 5 of them. Now, instead of celebrating where you are focusing on where they are. Maybe they are 25 years in ministry. You lose the direction that God wants to take you. Life and destiny is a process. Every one of us must go through the process. There's a period in your life where you go through a time, they call it the time of the wilderness, where it looks like there's no God. Where it looks like everything is falling apart.
Yes, sir.
Everybody must go through that. It's a process, sir.
Amen.
So if you have not been through that, you'll go through it. Why many people miss it is that they focus on the race that others are running. The Bible says, run your own race. Paul said, I have fought a good fight. He fought a fight. I have finished my race. He didn't say our race, my race. I have kept the faith. Every time you go to a place, forget what you know.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I went to my previous church. I got there. I was a pastoral head in Cameroon in a church. My wife was there in Yaoundé. And when I left that church, we started it from grassroots. When I left that church, there were about 700 of them in that church. We had no place. The hall we took was full. We rented a canopy outside full. There was no place for people to sit. And when I came to Europe, he probably didn't even know about that. Did you know about that? He did not know about that. When I came to Europe, I went to a church, asked him, I was the usher at the door. I was not looking for position. When I had to move to the other church, I was the usher. I was not looking for position. As soon as I got to the church, I asked God, God, what do you want me to do? God said, go and stand at the door. That pass is gone. I did not go there and tell him that this is what I was doing. No. I did not go there and tell him that I'm a church planter. Irrelevant. God does not care about that. He wants to open a new page in your life.
Amen.
The way he led you there is not the way he will lead you in a new place, sir.
Yes, sir.
That's the reason why Moses had to spend 40 years in the palace and 40 years in the wilderness. He was established. He has spent it in the wilderness, in the ghettos. He has spent it in the palace. So he had both experience. You cannot defeat a man like that, sir.
My God.
That's why he went with audacity in front of Pharaoh. Say, let my people go now. How can a man die? Can you go to the queen and say, let my people go now? Where have I been? They will lock you up. They will lock you where nobody will see you. But every day Moses appeared before Pharaoh and nobody said anything. They were trembling. The prayer every day, say, God, give me the power. That when I'll preach to Queen Elizabeth. In fact, when this church will grow, it will be a king. This one will be wiped out, a king will come. That's the prophecy.
Amen.
And I'll preach to, I saw myself, God showed me preaching to the king.
Amen.
Amen.
Then what is God doing now?
Hallelujah.
Your amen is low because you don't believe.
Amen.
What is God doing now? He's cooking you. He's cooking you so that today you come to church. He said, nobody bring them in except I bring them in.
Yeah.
So now you invited someone, you come, don't knock your chest and I brought them. No, sir, God brought them in.
Yes.
If God did not prick their heart, they will not come.
Yes, sir.
I don't know many people you have invited. You invite, you pray, nothing, they are not coming. You pick them, you call them, they don't pick their calls. They were not meant to be there, sir. I just leave them there. Hallelujah.
Yeah,
I'm just preparing your mind. You might have a job and you lost it. And you begin to cry. You are crying for what? You don't know the trap that was set for you there on that particular day that they call you and say you've lost the job. By the time you would have been there, something would have happened. But God saw that and said, no, I cannot let this happen. And instead of him letting you die, he made you lose the job. Because there are better jobs, sir. As long as you have life, you have hope, you can get any job you want. If I don't need job, you are an employer of labor.
Amen.
Some of you, God has taken that job away from you because he wants to open your mind to what he has in store for you. His plans for you is maybe business. He said, it's me. If God gave me 1 million 10 years ago, I will never hold this microphone. I'll be flying first class 2 and 4. Even this man may not see me. But God allowed, in fact, I was looking for a job after university, my job in my field, my law field. I could not get one in my field. Everywhere I went, I knew I was better qualified. In your head now, you say, don't worry, I'll get this job. Nothing, you come and say, I am sorry. My email was full with, I am sorry. Now when I say I'm sorry, I'm so angry. Because I'm so used to it. Because when you go to the interview, they are so happy with you. They think you are jovial, you are nice. Interact some of them, even tell that you have the job.
Yes.
Only for you to check your email and you are like, I'm sorry. You are sorry. Why? Because God was preparing me for this assignment.
Yeah.
I remember when I accepted this and I began. If you ever told me this man is my classmate, that I hold a microphone, forget it, sir. Forget it. Forget it. Forget it. I was preaching in my previous church, I was preaching in Cameroon. But it was not this kind of preaching. Hallelujah. It was preaching that you are preaching, you are still looking at women. Good are the fine ones in there. I'll see as it is. They went down on you. That Jesus is not a prayerful thing. It's a prayerful thing. It's not a prayerful thing. It's a prayerful. He's there, he knows. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's why there's so much nonsense going on in church. Traveled to Nigeria last time and they tell you they qualify people who study from by the tongues they speak. What nonsense. By the tongues they speak. They say since one is rich because of the Emalia kata, they are qualifying them by the tongue. Speaking in tongues. Pastor will pray for you, will locate you out by prophecy, and he will not pray for you. Why? Because he wants you in his office so that he can ask you a seat. So that he can pray for you there. There he will not pray for you. Because there he cannot ask you a seat. Nonsense going on in the church. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Planning is the art of capturing God's will for your life. So your planning gives definition to your faith. Planning pulls the promises out of eternity into time. Planning documents your vision. So planning is captured vision. Say never.
Never.
Your plan is captured vision. Because what you see is what you see. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What you see is what you see. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What you see is what. There is no way I will not have a plan for mission because I see it every day.
Yes, sir.
What you see is what you see.
Yes,
not see sometimes, see every day. And God will bring challenges. He will allow it to happen. Why did he allow me to go through? I am sorry. I became used to I'm sorry. Every time I check my email, I knew the next thing I'll see is I am sorry. But I did not know why. Until when I accepted this job as a pastor, a real pastor now. Not that one 20 years ago. Hallelujah. When I accepted this job as a pastor, God told me that I seized the job myself. He said, if I would have given the job then, you would have... If you have given a job there, you will not have accepted this call.
Yep.
For 1 million, I'm accepting call, pastor. Because in those days, we know that pastors are grown people. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Your own time, you will reign in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
God is not impressed by how great your vision is. What is your plan? Do you know that God himself is the greatest example of planning? God is a master planner. Ephesians 1:4. Let's read together Ephesians 1:4. Just as he has chosen us, Ephesians 1:4. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, so God knows exactly what you will be. God knows exactly. Look, God is not creating any new things. Everything you need, he has already created. Everything you need is already created. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. So before you were born, God already knew that you'll be a pastor. God already knew that you'll be an engineer. God already knew that you'll be this and be that. That we should be holy and without blame before him in love. So what God was doing there, he conceived the plan of redemption and then he documented his plan by writing it down in the Bible. Someone asked, can you change your plan? I've given you an example already. Yes, you can change your plan. God has an initial plan and he had to change the plan. But he had to change his plan because he had it in the first place. So you cannot change what you don't have in the first place. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
You cannot change what you don't have in the first place. God had to make new plans when his plan failed concerning Adam and Eve. But he could only change it because he had an original plan in the first place. Genesis 11:6. The Lord said, if as one people speaking the same language, they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Remember, they came together and said, let us build a tower that will take us to heaven. A tower of Babel. And they were in one accord. When God saw their plan, saw their pursuit for the plan. That's why I say it's not enough to give a plan, but it's enough to pursue it diligently. They were determined. They were building.
Yes.
Building. God said, my God, if I don't stop these people now, they'll get to heaven. He Imagine, God was scared when he saw a plan and he saw the zeal, the passion that the people had to pursue that plan. God himself had to come and say, you know what, let me scatter these people. Why? Because he saw the plan, saw their zeal, and knew that they, God himself knew that they would fulfill this one. God was scared, sir. God released confusion between them. They began to speak different languages. One accord. Hallelujah. They had a plan. So God knew that because they had planned it properly, come on now, the God of the universe, God concerned that they will fulfill it because they had a plan in place and they were motivated to fulfill that plan. So God himself had to come down and interrupt them. So that tells you that when man plans, heaven trembles. When man plans, heaven is in a hurry to fulfill it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Look, nothing scares me. I come here and meet one person here. I don't see one person. If God says you are going to London, you'll get to London if you see London.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You have an accident in Birmingham, you'll call a taxi. You can even head ahead. You'll get to London. As long as you see London.
Yes,
again, the second time a plan was mentioned in the Bible was from Joseph to Pharaoh. Genesis 41, 37, 45. Let's read together. Genesis 41, 37, 45. Let's read together quickly before we go. We have a few more minutes to go, about 5 minutes. Okay, verse 37, read 37, read 38. And the thing was good in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of all his servants. So Joseph became the governor. Why? Because he followed up with his plan. Do you think they were not mocking him in prison? So they mocked him in prison. But he saw the end from. Remember, the plan was the dream he had. Hallelujah. And he pursued it diligently. He did not move from. Even when, guess what? The wife of Potiphar came, right? And what happened? He said, I will not sleep with you. Why? Because he has his plan. He's pursuing his plan. He knew that this is a diversion. This is a derailment. Many are in church. They come and God tells them, this is the place you'll be. And the least thing offends them. Yes, they'll offend you. But what has God said to you? Whose report will you believe? What he's saying to you or what God has already initially told you? Read verse 38, please.
And Pharaoh said unto
him, read like you mean it.
Can we find such a one as this, a man in whom the Spirit of God is?
Verse 39. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, for as much as God has shared thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as thou art. So what, let me end there, we don't have the time. What was Joseph telling Pharaoh? The plan. He became governor because he showed them the plan for the next 7 years and the 7 years after. And what happened? They said, since you already know the plan, who else should we put in this place? A plan. Hallelujah.
Amen.
See, there's no one as wise as you who could devise a plan through the help of God. Because you already know the plan, let us put you in this place. I had a pastor friend who said he was looking for a job. He went to America and he was literally living in the street for 1 month. He was going through a lot. Every one of their tribes of Nigeria, every one of their people, they're refusing to accept him in their house. And he lived in the street for 1 month. But after a month, he went to a place to apply for a job. And they asked a question. It was a normal, you know, jobs are very funny. Sometimes they will just look at you in the mirror and say, you can take the job. But then they asked a question that they should add some things. And now he started praying, God, what are you saying? Like, and God gave him the answer. Now he's a director of that company.
Amen.
God can do anything. Anything. Now he's going to Nigeria. He's just roaming around. Anyhow, money everywhere. Why? Buy a plan. You go to that company, they are looking for things. God can tell you the answer.
Yes.
They're talking about everywhere. When I was working, every place I go, I was going there as a fixer. Because at my breaks, I don't eat. Then I was a fasting machine. Now I eat though. She has a fat. Then I don't eat. So when I go back there, everything came, everything was me. Now I had a company womb. When someone has messed things in a particular place, they'll move me from where I am, just like your job. They'll move me there and go and put me there so I can fix it. Because they know when I appear there, I'll fix it.
Yeah.
I wasn't fixing it by my natural wisdom. It was the wisdom of God. During break time, while they were eating, I was kabashi in the car. And when I come back, solution instantly.
a plan. Hallelujah.
Amen. In Exodus 26:30, set up the tabernacle according to the plan shown you on the mountain. God here gave Moses a clear plan on how to build a tabernacle on the mountain. A clear plan. It is all over the Bible. Sir, God told Noah, build the ark. That's what the children are learning today. Build the ark, precise dimension. I don't understand. Do you know that wood does not float on water? That kind of wood against you does not float on water, sir.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a special kind.
God said, build the roof on up. Roofs are not built off, sir. Roofs are built by the side. So that when there's a problem, you will know from where come here. When there's a problem, you can look from where come here. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Psalms 24 says, may he give you the desire of your heart and make all your plans succeed. So you must have a plan before he can give you the desires of your heart. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Desire here talks of God giving you the vision and you present your plan for the vision. So that tells you that you must have a written plan presented unto him for him to make them succeed. Finally, as we round up, go to Proverbs 16:1. Quickly. Proverbs 16:1. Let's read Proverbs 16:1. It says, the preparation of the heart in man and the answer of the Lord is of the tongue is from the Lord. So you are responsible for putting the plan in place, and God is responsible for explaining to you how he is going to accomplish it. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So that tells you not to worry after you submit the plan, because how he is going to do it, I've said it already, is none of your business. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
God is saying, don't be afraid to be bold. Make a big plan. The plan of the house I made in Cameroon was so big, gigantic. I didn't know I was going to achieve it. Hallelujah. Make a big plan. Take the first step, God will fulfill it. Say glory.
Glory.
I don't like your glory at
glory.
All. Proverbs 16:2. What does it say? Proverbs 16:2. It says, all the ways of a man are clean in his own eyes, but the Lord weigheth what?
Spirit.
The spirit. If you plan it according to your worldly wisdom, you'll fail. Lean on the Lord. Lean not on your own understanding. That is what he's saying once you've given the plan. Don't think about how it is going to happen. It is just going to happen. Once you put the plan in place, God will give you the results.
Amen.
So before you put that plan in writing, check your motives. If your plan is for your personal enjoyment, then it is not from the Lord, and it will not happen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Proverbs 16:3. Let's read Proverbs 16:3. What does it say? It says, commit their works unto the Lord, and their thoughts shall be established. What are your thoughts, your plans? Commit them unto the Lord, and they shall be established. Proverbs 16:4. Read, let's read together. It says, the Lord had made all things for himself. Yeah. Even the wicked for the day of... Even the wicked... I was reading this, and God was giving me this idea. So I was like, God, even the wicked for the day of... So put the enemy in your plan. I don't want to go down here. Put battles in your plan. Put what?
Battles.
There is no way if it is from God, there will be battles. If it is from God, there will be battles. Is it a marriage? Is it a business? Is it a career? Look, I heard this explanation somewhere. When a footballer is playing, you will never have a position without an opposition. No, you cannot have a position without an opposition. You cannot win a race without an opposition. Oppositions are your Goliaths. They'll come after you. But when they come after you, think about it. It means you have the ball. That should make you more confident. When a footballer has the ball, it is his time. You see people chasing him. Even the goalkeeper of the other team will run and come and chase him. You forget. You understand what I'm saying? So that means that is your time. You have the ball. And the closer he is to the goalpost, everybody on the other side will come. Don't forget that position. Everybody will come out so that he does not score. So every time you face a problem or a battle, wake up and say, God, I thank you, and begin to thank God. Hallelujah. It means you are closer to the goalpost. Say glory.
Glory.
Is are we understanding that?
Yes.
Let's round up with this. Proverbs 16:5. It says what?
Everyone that is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord.
The
joined in hand, it shall not be unfounded.
Okay, what I understood by that is that when that time comes, there will be mockers. There will be people along the way who you know, who you go and ask for help, and they'll say, no, I cannot help you. But the Bible says that when you get to the top, don't pay evil for evil. Leave them to God. I did not say witches. Witches are different. Witches, they, you, any place they kill them.
Amen.
Say, I say so.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Bible says that suffer not a wish to live. But the Bible talks about normal people. We are not fighting this. When we are saying kick, we are not killing people. We are killing who?
Spirits.
So when you have been people in places where people you thought will help you, as soon as you get there, they disappear.
That's right.
They don't know you.
Yeah.
That's what the Bible is saying. Just leave them to. When you go and fight a man and you say, you know what, I leave you to God, be afraid. Go and pray. If he has a clean heart and he goes back to God and pray, you are in trouble.
Mm.
When you fight a man and if you see me and say, I leave you to God, fear that one.
Mm.
Stand up on your feet. Let's stand up. Father, we just thank you. Lord, we celebrate you. Lord, we rejoice you. Thank you and thank you and thank you.
Thank
we bless you, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. Are you thanking him? Thank him. Thank him. Thank him. Thank him. Thank him and thank him and thank him. Thank him and thank him and thank him. Father, we just thank you. Lord, we celebrate you. Lord, we rejoice you. Lord, we honor you. In Jesus' name, we have prayed.
Amen.
Stretch your hands as I release the prophetic blessing as we go. I declare and declare by the power of the Holy Ghost, this end of month, the angels of God at Word and Fire Ministry takes over your battles in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Right where you are, receive what you have been asking God for in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Those that have vowed that you cannot be anything, the right hand of God is power. I terminate the assignment in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I see your fight being attended now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Everywhere they may have spoken ill of you, I correct that error in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I declare and I declare that court case that has concluded against you overnight, let it be reversed in your favor in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let it be reversed in your favor in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Lamentation 3:37 says, who is it that said and come to pass when God himself commanded it not? Therefore, I speak by prophecy
under the mandate of God
and Word and Fire Ministry. Let your attackers be attacked now by fire in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let your attackers be attacked now by fire in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Someone here in your family, there's a recurring event, asthma. That asthma, God told me that
this morning.
That asthma is terminated in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I decree that what others may have struggled to get for a year, you will get it in 10 days in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You will get it cheaply in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Anyone that has made you weep in the past, let the fire to the matter in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
That spirit that makes you go back to square one, I declare, it dies now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I kill that experience on the roof in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I kill that experience on the roof in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Wherever they say you cannot get married, I am your spiritual father. I am married, so I prophesy. Your marriage is confirmed in the name of Jesus. Wherever they said you will not get promotion, I am your spiritual father. We move from that building to here. That's a promotion. I confirm your promotion in the name of Jesus. Wherever they said you will not get your own house, I am your spiritual father. I have a house. I declare your house is confirmed in the name of Jesus. Wherever they said you cannot have that car, I am your spiritual father. I have a car. Your car is confirmed in the name of Jesus. Wherever they said you will not have a business empire, I am your spiritual father. I have a business. Your business is confirmed in the name of Jesus. Your amen is looking for my trouble. Where they said you cannot have a child, I have children. I declare your child is confirmed in the name of Jesus. You pregnant in the name of Jesus. Where they said you will not be blessed, I am blessed. Therefore, receive the blessings in the name of Jesus. Say, shall it be in Jesus' name. Where they said your immigration breakthrough will not land, I am your spiritual father, a bona fide citizen of this nation. Take your British passport in the name of Jesus. Take
your British passport in the name of Jesus. Take your British passport in the name of Jesus. Take your British passport in the name of Jesus. So shall it be in Jesus' name. Shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. I remember Sister Kamala said to me, Pastor, I'm going for this exam for my British passport. I don't know whether I'll pass. I said to her, I have a British passport. Hallelujah. And you cannot be sitting under me and your father has a British passport and you don't have. Hallelujah. I say, go, you will get the pass. And she went, she got her pass. Today she's a British citizen. God bless you. Thank you, Father. Let us share the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus. Shout hallelujah. Let's go to your neighbor and wish them a good week. Tell them something good as a good.